सहनावतु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्म विद्वरम्। सो वी वर डूइंग द गणपति अथर्व शीर्ष उपनिषद एंड एवरी उपनिषद हैज अ शांति मंत्र। सो वी विल चांट द शांति मंत्र ऑफ दिस। आई हैव सेंड द पीडीएफ फाइल ऑल्सो वंस अगेन ऑन द ग्रुप सो यू कैन यूज दैट। ओम भद्रम कर्णे शृणुयाम देवा भद्रम पश्येमाक्ष भूयजत्रा स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टुवांसस्तनूभिः व्यशेम देवहितं यदायुः। स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। We had seen the first mantra where we worship Lord Ganesha as the Supreme Brahman, the infinite reality, the consciousness. Then we also saw that he is the Ishvara, Karta, Dharta, Harta. He alone has become this whole universe. And he is also our Atma, Tvam Sakshat Atma Si Nityam. Now, going to the second mantra, the Rishi here says, Ritam Vachmi, Satyam Vachmi. He says, I am telling you the Ritam and Satyam. So, Ritam means the truth which is elaborated or indicated in the scriptures. And Satyam means which is the experiential truth. So like we see, any concept will be explained first in pure science, then there will be applied science. The application of it will be there. In any subject actually it applies. So in the manuals of art, let us say somebody is learning art, then they will describe what is a caricature, what is perspective, what is portrait, what is landscape. You know, what are the proportions? Suppose you want to draw a human being. So then some people have a body which is 4 times the size of their head. Some people have a body which is 7 times the size of the head. So these are theories, these are explanations, these are concepts given in the pure science. Then there is an application of it. So when we actually start drawing, so then using perspective, we draw certain things, you know, using the portrait aspect, we draw certain things. So that is the application. So here he says that what I am going to say is not only revealed by the scriptures about Lord Ganesha, but it is also my personal experience. Ritam Vachmi, Satyam Vachmi. So he is not only talking about some theory that he has not experienced, nor is he talking about only some experience that he has, which has no theoretical or the scriptural validity. The combination of these two is most beautiful. That which is time-tested is the spiritual wisdom, the scriptural wisdom. And that time-tested wisdom is experienced by the seeker, by the devotee. So it gets validated. The seekers, when they apply this and they experience it, proves that the scriptures, what they are saying is true. So the greatest proof of the script, the validity of the scriptures is the life and the experience of the great saints and the sages. Because what is written there, that God is real, In fact, God alone is real, rest everything else is illusion. They experience that. To a certain extent, we also experience what the scriptures have said. If we apply, so for example, if they say that happiness is not outside, happiness is a state of our mind. When the mind is calm, we are happy. Any desire, when it is fulfilled, we actually experience the happiness born out of a calm mind. The external object is only serving to quieten the agitation. So suppose I had a desire for coffee. So now the disturbance in the mind will be there. Coffee. I must drink coffee. From where will I get a coffee? You know, till that disturbance is there, I am not happy. When I actually get the coffee, that disturbance is gone. So I may experience pleasure of the coffee at the tongue level, but the real happiness is coming because the mind has become quiet. The craving, the hankering, the agitation, all has gone. So this is one example. Like that, scriptures give so many examples that if we learn to control our senses, our concentration will improve. If we learn to surrender the ego to Bhagavan, we will feel more secure and strong. So these are scriptural declarations. When we apply it in our life, we see the power of it, we see the transformation in our life. And that is why both these are important. We should study the scriptures and then apply. And what we apply is validated. The scripture gets validated by what we experience when we apply. Some people say, why should I study scripture? It is all in my internal experience. I will face life as it comes with whatever inside I feel, I will respond in that way. I mean, one can do that, but how does one know that one is not getting carried away by some attachment? How does one know that one is not just carried away by some ego? Because the mind and the ego of ours are very subtle. So what is that which is the deciding factor to help us to understand what is right, what is wrong? See, Arjun, for that matter, at that point in time, his mind said that he should run away from the battlefield. And so many reasons he gave in the first chapter. When we read all those reasons, we actually feel that what Arjun saying was right. Because so many, so much of disturbances and culture will decline and the society will go through so much of destruction. The Pitrus will fall. The gender ratio in the society will get disturbed. Value like Ahimsa will get, violated. So he gives so many reasons there. Now, if we think, yes, what he's saying is right, but Bhagwan whips him up and he says, you are not acting as you are supposed to. You are a Kshatriya. You should be strong. Drop this weakness of heart. Get up and do your duty. So we really don't know many times what is right and what is wrong. Right appears as wrong, wrong appears as right. That's why Bhagavan says in the Gita, Tasmat Shastram Pramanam Te Karya Karya Vyavasthitav. Hence, the valid means of determining what is right and what is wrong is the scripture and the time-tested knowledge of the scriptures. Jnatva Shastra Vidhanoktam Karma Kartum Iharasi. Understand what the scriptures say and then act. Then we will not be acting out of ego. We will at least become alert. Yo, this is what the scriptures say. There is a standard against which I can compare. Otherwise, there is no standard. My ego sets any standard. And that standard can be very low also. So who knows what is right, what is wrong. So the tested knowledge, the great wisdom of our scriptures, we should use that. Why reinvent the wheel? And we are anyway doing that for many subjects or not. When we want to understand law, then we go back to the books of law to understand whether an action is legal, illegal, punishable, not punishable, what is offense, what is not offense. We go back to the books of law. The same way for science, we go back to the books of science, and so many scientists have done experiment. But please remember, in this, many times what happens is what was right at one point changes. It's very interesting. Stephen Hawking, he got his PhD on the thesis that universe is not beginningless. Universe has a beginning. So he got his doctorate on that thesis that universe has a beginning. And after he got his doctorate and he kept doing research, he negated his own thesis. He said, no, 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 universe doesn't have any beginning, it is beginningless. Because ever, you know, his thought process also evolved over a period of time, his understanding of the universe changed. So in the worldly things, that knowledge keeps changing. Scriptures are the time-tested principles which we can apply at all times. And the scriptures also have a flexible part, which is what we call as the Smriti. So Shruti is the Vedas, which are the time-tested eternal principles. How to apply them in our daily life in the changing contexts? Many great rishis have given us Smriti. So Manu Smriti, Yajnavalkya Smriti, Parashar Smriti. You know, there are different Smritis. Bhagavad Gita itself is a Smriti. So when we start applying, if there has to be some adaptation that has to be made, then that is called Satyam here. Anchoring in the eternal principles, we should learn to adapt. So Ritam Vachmi, Satyam Vachmi. So here, as far as Ganapati Atharva Shirsha Upanishad is concerned, here the Rishi is saying that I am not saying something out of my own whim and fancy. What I am saying is approved by the scriptures and it is confirmed by my experience, both. In the world, we think seeing is believing. But when we come to Vedanta, seeing is belying actually. Because what we see is not real. And what is real, we are not seeing. So seeing is believing is only relying on the senses. But when we understand what the scripture is saying and we have Shraddha in the Shastra, then belief or Shraddha in the Shastra, then believing is what is seen. And when we believe that God is real and we put our faith in the Shastra and then we start doing sadhana, what we have believed, that will become real. That's one of the definitions of faith. Faith is to believe what we don't see. The result of it is we will see what we believe. Faith is to believe what we don't see. The result of it is we will see what we believed in. And without faith, these aspects which are beyond the mind, beyond the intellect, beyond the senses, cannot be experienced. That's why in the Gita 4th chapter, Bhagavan says, Shraddhavan labhate jnanam. The person who has faith, that person will know the truth. So, Ritam Vachmi, Satyam Vachmi. Anchoring in the scriptural knowledge, let us apply what we have studied and then experience it for ourselves. Ritam Vachmi, Satyam Vachmi. Why this is important also is because many people, they don't want to study the scripture because they say it is all written thousands of years back. We don't know whether it is true or not because they have not thought properly. Nor have they analyzed the life and experiences of people who have applied it. Some vested interest, some agenda has gone into the head, some false narrative is set, and then one condemns the scripture also. But it is a time-tested knowledge, beautiful knowledge, which transforms our life. So the Rishi here says that I anchor in both these, Ritam Vachmi, Satyam Vachmi. Then the third mantra, he moves on to pray to Bhagwan for protection. Avatvam mam, O Lord, you please protect me. See, this one paragraph, you see, this third mantra, in these difficult times, if you want to feel more security, more strength, and pray for the grace of Bhagwan, for the protection of Bhagwan, then repeat this third mantra again and again with the understanding. So first I will just take the simple meaning, then we go into the deeper meaning. Avatvam mam means to, O Lord, you please protect me. Avavaktaram, protect the speaker. Avashrotaram, protect the listener. Avadataram, protect the giver. Avadhataram, protect the nourisher, the supporter. Then, avanujanam, ava, shishyam. So, anujana. Anujanam means the teacher who teaches the Vedic rites, rituals, etc. And shishya. So, protect the teacher, protect the student. Then, ava paschat, protect me from behind. Ava purastat, protect me from front. Ava uttarat, protect me from the north. Ava dakshinat, protect me from the south. Avacha urdhva avatat, protect me from above, protect me from below. This is called all-round protection. East, west, north, south, up, down, meaning all 10 directions, you please protect me. Ava urdhvatat avadharatat. Sarvatomam pahi pahi samantat. From all sides, in every way, you please protect me. And all of us need this or not. This time, right now, so we need tremendous protection. From all sides, may the virus not affect us and other people also. That is a physical protection. We also need mental protection. Bhagwan, please protect our mental balance, because we get anxious sometimes, we get nervous sometimes, we feel scared sometimes. Unfortunately, so many people are getting into depression. They are getting into suicidal tendencies. Things are tough. There is no doubt in that. And it is at these times that one has to invoke grace of Bhagwan. Bhagwan, please protect. So, avatvam mam, coming to the deeper meaning. Oh Lord, you please protect me. So, this is a protection at different levels. So, first protection is at the physical level. Ki Bhagwan, please protect my physical body. May I have good health. May I have no diseases. Protect all my senses. Because every single sense is such a great blessing. Think about it. If one sense organ does not function, oh my God, what a disadvantage it will become. If any organ of the body doesn't function, big challenge. So Bhagwan, please protect all the limbs of my body. Protect this physical body. So one is physical protection. And what helps to protect this body, please protect that also. So I live in a home. There is a security. I have a physical security. I have where I am staying in a home, protected from the onslaught of the weather and, you know, unwanted elements and all that. So please protect this home. Please protect this body. And why should this body be protected? Especially human body is most precious equipment to do sadhana. Please protect so that I can do sadhana and realize the truth. Because when will I get the next human body? No idea. I can do sadhana, I can do seva, I can do swadhyay, I can live in sanyam, all that is possible in human body. So Bhagwan, you please protect me at these times. And also if we are protected, we can help others, we can protect others. So avatvam mam, physically please protect me. Mentally please protect my peace of mind, my balance of mind. May I not become anxious, may I not become depressed, may I not fall for so many hoax messages keep coming. So may I retain my balance of mind, may I remain inspired, focused. May please protect my devotion also. The mind must have bhavana for Bhagwan. So please protect my devotion. You know, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to give this example that when a sapling, it is very young, then that sapling needs protection. The fence will be put around that sapling to protect it from, you know, the cattle or any other animal like dog or any other animal who can come and destroy it. So it needs a fence, it needs a protection. But as it grows and it becomes a strong, mighty tree, then it doesn't need any protection. In the same way, our bhakti, our sadhana, in the beginning, we need to protect it. And that's why many great masters, they suggest that initial sadhana one should do in secret. It is called Gupta sadhana. That let people not know about it. Do it in a secret way. Why secret way? Because sometimes people's comments can affect us. Sometimes people may discourage us. Sometimes they may say, why are you doing this right now? Is everything okay? Because they think that only when troubles come, then we should think about Bhagwan. Otherwise, no need. Or they may pass any, very light comment, whether God exists or not also, who knows, and why are you wasting your time? Or we may also get ahankar, ki I am a great seeker, and look at people, they look at me and every day I am doing sadhana, so there is an image that he is a very dharmatma purusha. So to avoid all that, we have to protect our sadhana. So Bhagwan, please protect my sadhana, especially in difficult times, sadhana must become more intense. My teacher told me once very nice thing. He said, when your mind is disturbed, you should meditate to quieten the mind. And when your mind is not disturbed also, you should meditate to go deeper. So in either situation, you must meditate. Don't give excuse. See, right now, my mind is so fine. Everything is so nice. Why should I meditate? That is the time when I should meditate to go very deep. And when the mind is disturbed, then the mind says, right now I can't do japa, my mind is too disturbed, it will just wander away everywhere. That is the time to do sadhana so that quieten this mind. So either way, there is no excuse. So, oh Lord, you please protect my sadhana. If my sadhana is protected, I am protected. Because we have to anchor. Sadhana is helping us to anchor in that supreme. So, one is physical protection, protection of the house, protection of the people who are helping me, serving me. Second is protection of our mind, the mental balance. May my mind be positive, inspired. And may my mind, sadhana, be protected. Third is intellectual protection, where we need protection for the very desires, goals that we have, which we want to achieve. It may be material goals, it may be, psychological goals, spiritual goals, financial goals, whatever goals it may be. There has to be a certain focused approach to achieve. Obstacles will keep coming. But may I not lose my enthusiasm and may my mind have a certain goal. You see, one of the biggest causes of depression is this, that there is no goal clarity. One feels worthless. One feels, what is the point of life? One is not able to handle certain situations. One feels it is all useless, worthless, and one goes to such a low in the energy levels that one decides, I want to just quit. So goal clarity. Bhagwan, please protect my goal clarity. Like Arjun, his goal changed. The moment his identity changed, his goal changed. 12 years he prepared to fight the war, because the goal was to ensure that dharma is protected as a soldier. But when his identity changed to a personal relationship, his goal changed. So, oh Lord, please help me to retain goal clarity. I should not allow emotions to overwhelm me. I should not lose my clarity of goal. I should not feel that this goal is useless, worthless. Why should I even achieve any of these? So protect the goal clarity. It may be any form of goal. So that is intellectually. Externally also, we have various aspects where we have, you know, finance, investment, money, whatever, land, property, jewels, so many things that one has. Bhagavan, please protect all that. So this is a prayer, Avatvam Mam, please protect me in a holistic way. And protect my spiritual seeking, that is a spiritual aspect. May I not drop the attitude that I am a devotee, I am a seeker. In and through all challenges of life, all relationships, all my work, may I not forget that I am mainly a seeker who has come here to evolve. That vision I should not forget. Other things are roles I am playing, but my main identity is I am a devotee or I am a seeker. That identity I should never forget. Because if that identity I forget, then I get attached in various roles and I lose myself. So I am a seeker. My connection with the Lord is the only eternal connection. In the 15th chapter of the Gita, Bhagavan says that, Mamaivamsho jiva loke. Jiva Bhuta Sanatanaha. This Jiva is my Amsha. And this Jiva is Sanatan. And our Sambandha is Sanatan. In every life, people change. Based on karma, the people change. But Bhagavan is same. And luckily people change. Imagine same set of people we have to connect again and again and again. In one life itself, sometimes we find it difficult. Life after life, if it is the same person, then more problem. So scripture though doesn't say that once you marry, then seven janmas you will carry on. Scripture doesn't say that. People have created. Shastra says, according to karma, you will come together, relate, again depart, again come together. That all happens based on karma. And that is a good thing, that people change. But in that changing people and changing relationships, we should not forget the changeless Bhagavan. Mirabai said so nicely, Mere to Giridhar Gopal dusro na koi. I worship Giridhar Gopal, he is my Ishta. Rest of the things, they come and go. So that attitude that I am a seeker and I am connected to Bhagavan eternally, at all times Bhagavan is in my heart, that knowledge, Bhagavan, please protect. Because it is Bhagavan's maya only which makes us forget that knowledge. Bhagavan is very naughty, you see. He is sitting in our own heart and deluding us. Ishvara Sarvabhutanam Hriddeshe Arjuna Tishtati. He is in the heart. And what is he doing? Brahmayan Sarvabhutani. He is deluding all the jivas by making them extrovert, by making them seek happiness outside. Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. With his maya, he makes everybody extrovert. So the seeker prays, oh Bhagavan, you please protect me from your maya and make me turn within. I must recognize you first. Forgetting you, I am running behind the world. I will not get anything here. It is a constantly changing world, perishable world. So please protect me. Avatvam Mam. Now this is a prayer of the devotee. How does Bhagavan actually protect? So various ways through which Bhagavan protects. See, when we say protect, our notion of protection also must become clear. Notion of protection is not that no harm will ever come. The protection is, in spite of the harm which may happen, we are still saved. Our mind is, you know, balanced, or it can bounce back quickly. Physically, we may go through a disease, but we will come back to health. So protection is not that a devotee will never face any problems, never face any disease, never face any mental disappointment. That is an unrealistic expectation. Why? Because we face what we face because of our own karmas. Bhagavan is a karma phala data. So first thing, the first type of protection of Bhagavan is when he gives the results of our actions to us, through that he protects. See, hard work when we do, we earn the money, we build a house, and that house protects us. How did we get the result? Bhagavan is the karma phala data. From where did the five elements come? How we made the house? He is the Lord who created the five elements. So every single jiva gets the result of their own karma, and the karma phala, positive karma phala or the negative karma phala, both are sent by Bhagavan as per the karma of the jiva. So the protection through positive karma phala, we understand ki somebody gets well, somebody gets, you know, house, somebody gets some prosperity, somebody has a blessing of a child, family, people who love us. So that is a positive karma phala, which we call as punya karma. So when we have done punya karma, then the result of that is all these good things. Who inspired us to do that punya karma? So Bhagavan is not only karma phala data who protects us, he is also karma adhyaksha. He only inspires us to do the karma. He protects us through our purushartha. When we put our self effort, we are protected from our own laziness, lethargy, tamoguna. So purushartha kshamata is the second type of protection. Now even the negative karma phala that we get, Bhagavan protects us even through that. That is a little difficult to understand. How is Bhagavan protecting us through the negative karma phala? Mother scolding a child to save the child is a protection or not? Sometimes the mother may give one, depending on what the child has done, sometimes just one tapli, sometimes one tight slap. That is also protection. Mother's intention is not to hurt the child. Mother's intention is only to protect. If the child has done something where the child is not understanding and the child will face some, you know, harm. Now suppose the child is putting the hand in the fire. Now mother gives one. Because the child is not understanding after telling so many times, and mother gives one. Now for us it will be a pain. Oh, mother gave one. The child feels mother hit me. But if the child has put the hand in the fire, that hand will burn. That is a greater sorrow. Many times Bhagavan teaches us hard lessons to prevent us from falling further, to prevent us from suffering more. That also is protection of Bhagavan only. You see, in the 16th chapter, Bhagavan actually says that when somebody does not follow righteousness, and you know, opportunities are given, and that person is has all knowledge but still doesn't follow and gives in to the lower tendencies, asuri bhav, then he says, what does Bhagavan says? Tanaham dvishata kruran samsareshu naradhaman kshipami ajasram ashubhan asuri shveva yonishu. That I will send them to hell. because their karma phala will deserve them to go to hell, and they will get purified there. Because when they go through a difficult time there, they will understand, "Kare, I should not have done such a karma." Because he has taught many ways in different ways, but this person didn't understand. So then finally, Bhagwan has to take a hard step. He will take hard step also. All in the interest of the devotee. So both positive karma phala also is Bhagwan's kripa. Negative karma phala also is Bhagwan's kripa. And if sometime karma phala doesn't come on time when we want it, that is also Bhagwan's kripa only. Because we want it in certain time. This has to happen by this time. But there are so many cosmic forces are at play. Bhagwan knows what is the right time to give the karma phala. So he protects us by the timing of the karma phala also. Is it not true that many times we have thought, "Oh, this should not have happened to me," and at that moment we will be so disappointed, dejected. But when we look back, then we realize, "Oh God, it was such a big grace of the Lord that this didn't happen to me at that time. Otherwise, I would not have known how to deal with it." So in hindsight, we realize, "Oh, this," at that time we may be very agitated. So positive karma phala also Bhagwan's protection, negative karma phala also is protection, and if karma phala doesn't come at the time that we want, that is also his grace and protection. And you know, fourth type of protection is when we really pray to Bhagwan, sometimes Bhagwan does not give karma phala. He takes it away. You know, sincerely when we pray to the Lord saying, "Bhagwan, I am really sorry, I should not have done this, but I did it out of ignorance, I did it out of my attachments, I did, I am extremely sorry, please, please, please forgive me." Bhagwan says, "Okay, forgiven. Karma account of that particular karma deleted, so you will not get karma phala." "No, no, no, that we don't believe. Are in the world the president can give a, you know, if a criminal files a mercy petition, the president can pardon the death sentence and, you know, commute the death sentence to life imprisonment, or even life imprisonment, that sentence can be commuted. And if they have good behavior, then on good behavior grounds, they can be released earlier. If in the world that can, it can be done, in Bhagwan's justice, why it cannot be done?" And that is what Bhagwan shows through so many of his leelas. When the devotee actually feels, the repentance, and one says, "I am extremely sorry, please forgive me, I will not do this again," Bhagwan says, "Okay, fine, maaf kar diya." So Bhagwan's protection happens in these five different ways. So when he says avatvam mam, Bhagwan protects. By his grace, by his presence, he protects. By sending people at the right time also, he protects us. If today there are people to take care of us, whether it is relationships, family, a child has mother, father, a family is there. Suppose some child is not having mother, father, some other caretaker, guardian, somebody comes. How many birds, plants, animals, everybody is being protected or not? So Bhagwan protects. And certain times there are certain things go by the law of karma. So Bhagwan's protection, avatvam mam. So he can protect us through people. He can protect us directly. Then he can also protect us by giving us that inner strength to overcome our problems, to help us to find solutions, to help us to meet certain people or have certain types of interaction where we can understand what are the solutions. How do I overcome this problem? How can I safeguard myself? Like so many doctors, they have understood what is the coronavirus, how does it spread, and they have given so many things that, you know, wear the mask and wash the hands, keep social distancing, Now the people who have the knowledge, who have diagnosed the cause, they have understood, they have shared the knowledge. Now if we follow those guidelines, we will be protected. So protection of the Lord happens through many ways. We have to open up our mind. When we understand that every single moment Bhagwan's grace is there with me, protecting me, we will not become insecure. Our problem is we judge the protection of Bhagwan with the positive results. If the result is negative, we say there is no protection of Bhagwan. There is no Bhagwan. We have to come out of that little mindset and see the totality. So, avatvam mam, O Lord, you please protect me. Then he says, avavaktaram, please protect the speaker. Speaker meaning here, whoever is sharing knowledge. Anybody who is sharing. Avavaktaram. You know, there's a very nice shloka which says, Shateshu jayate shuraha sahasreshu cha panditaha. Vakta dasa sahasreshu data bhavati vanava. Shateshu jayate shuraha. In hundreds of people, one person will be a very bold, courageous person. Sahasreshu cha pandita. Amongst 1,000 people, there will be one pandit, meaning somebody who has studied the Vedas, scriptures, knowledgeable person. Among 10,000 people will be a speaker who comes forward to share the knowledge and speak. Vakta dasa sahasreshu, data bhavati vanava. But a donor may be there, may not be there. Meaning people are not, see, to find a speaker is rare, but to find a donor is the rarest because people don't want to give. Anyway, the shloka here is meant mainly for the vakta. Vakta dasa sahasreshu. Is it not true that after the fear of death, the second largest fear is the fear of public speaking. People don't want to speak in front of people. You know, below the platform, this person can talk for hours together, but tell that person, go on the platform and talk. It doesn't open, the mouth doesn't open, because suddenly one is image conscious, ki, what are these 1,000 people sitting in front of me, what are they going to talk about me, how will I be able to express, what if I make some blunder. You know, in our training, when we go through training in Sandipani Sadhanalaya, so there are public speaking practice also we do. So in Gurudev's time, he started it. So one student came to Gurudev, he was very nervous. He said, Swamiji, I feel very scared, you know, I can't talk in front of people. You know, what if I make some mistake? What if I make some blunder? You know, please help me. He says, you have studied Vedanta, no? You understand karma, right? So if you make a blunder, it is the prarabdha of the audience. What is your problem? You don't worry. You just fire off. You study well. You understand properly. And you speak. The audience has to tolerate you. Worst come worst, if you have so much of fear, you close your eyes and speak. So we don't have to worry. This fear of public speaking has to go. So, vakta, avavaktaram, Bhagwan, please protect me, protect the speaker, avatvammam, avavaktaram. Many, you know, companies or political parties and other places, they have spokesperson, official spokesperson who will, you know, give a statement on behalf of the company or the party, or who will clarify doubts, or who will explain what is the stand, etc. Official spokesperson. That person must have clarity. So Bhagavan, please protect the spokesperson, the person who is willing to speak, because what we speak has a lot of effect, lot of impact. And you are seeing that happening in this world right now. Sad thing is happening right now. How people are getting tortured just out of ego for telling the truth, not even for insulting or anything, just for telling the truth, how that person is being tortured, unfortunately. So the speech is very, very powerful. You know, it is said, Jivagre Vasate Lakshmi. At the tip of the tongue, Mother Lakshmi resides. How we speak, you know, salespeople and all of them, they can convince you to buy something that you know don't need with the money that you don't have to show it to the people who don't care. You see? That's the power, Vak Shakti they have. You know, they can convince you so, you know, beautifully that you feel, no, I need this. I may not have the money for it, but now I have to buy it because now he has created the need. So, Jivagre Vasate Lakshmi. Jivagre Mitra Bandhavaha. At the tip of the tongue are also all relationships. How we speak, we can make relationships or we can break relationships. And Jivagre Maranam Dhruvam. And at the tip of the tongue also is Yamraj. Where if I speak, I can be killed, I can be finished, I can get a wrong, I can get a, you know, death sentence also. So this speech is very, very powerful. So the speaker, may the speaker be protected, may the speaker use intelligence and speak. And definitely think before speaking, not speak after that, think and then justify. Aray Rama, that naughty comment is very naughty, terrible. Person spoke something and then is justifying it by saying it means naughty. Areva, you should have thought before speaking. So speaking without thinking, that is a problem of a speaker. So protect the speaker by making that speaker think before speaking. So avavaktaram, avashrotaram, protect the listener. Bhagavan, please protect the listener. Why? Because what we gain, all the knowledge we gain is through listening. In the another Shanti Mantra it comes, Shrutam me gopaya, whatever I have heard or whatever I have, you know, the knowledge I have gained through listening, gopaya, please protect. Oh Lord, please protect that knowledge. What we hear should go into our heart and manifest in our hands. Cross ventilation should not happen. One year, the other year is out. No. Please protect. And there are so many people who are called professional listeners. They go to every lecture and go on listening. How much is gone inside, how much one absorbs and how much one is applying, that is very questionable. I'm not saying don't listen to other people. One can listen, but some people just like to listen. They don't reflect, they don't digest it, they don't assimilate. So he says, Bhagavan, please protect the listener. Which means all of us, as sadhaks, we are listening to satsang or, you know, even Bhagavan Naam or Kirtan or any such thing. Whatever we listen to, what is helping us to evolve, we should learn to assimilate that within us. And what is not necessary to remember, just forget it. So that vivek has to happen for a listener. What to retain and what to let go. So many unnecessary things, gossip and all kinds of information is there in our head. That I should let go. Let the mind be clean and pure. So ava shrotaram, ava tvammam, ava vaktaram, avashrotaram. Now it is said there are three types of listeners. So one is called sota, who just sleeps. In a lecture you will find many people. They just sleep. Because in Bhagavatam it comes, you know. that everybody was given an abode by the Lord. So Nidra Devi came to Brahmaji and said, please give me also some abode. Where will I stay? So Brahmaji, it seems, said, you can stay in satsang. So many people sleep in satsang. So first type of listener is called Sota, who goes on sleeping. Second type of listener is called Sarota. Sarota means the nutcracker, you know, this supari and all that, we keep cracking that. So this second type of listener is called Sarota. What does that person do? That person goes on finding faults with the speaker. This could have been spoken better, or this idea is not correct. I don't agree with this idea. I don't think this person is knowledgeable. Goes on cutting or arguing for the sake of arguing. So Sota, Sarota, and then third is Shrota, who properly listens with attentiveness, with single-pointedness, with the right intention, and absorbs. So we have to be the third category, not Sota and Sarota. We have to be Shrota. So our Shrotaram. Then, and the beauty, we have seen earlier satsang also, the whole video on listening and how to listen. Bhagwan gave us 2 ears and 1, you know, mouth. So we listen more, speak less. So our Shrotaram, then our Dataram, please protect the donor, the giver, the supporter. Because one should see, Daan is not optional actually. Many people think it is optional. Daan is not optional. Daan is a Kartavya Karma. In the 18th chapter of the Gita, Bhagavan says, Yajna Daana Tapak Karma Na Tyajyam Karyam Eva Tat. These three don't leave them. What? Doing yajna, meaning working together as a team for a selfless cause. Dana, charity, share what you have in abundance. And tapa is austerity. He says these three have to be done. Austerity is at the the intellectual level, concentration, contemplation, that is the austerity meant here. Yajna is at the emotional level, where we identify with a selfless cause and learn to work together with harmony, sinking all our differences. That is at a mental level. And Daan is at the physical level, where we actually share our resources, our wealth, our items that we have. And not only gross Daan, but then subtler Daan also. Prem Daan, Jnan Daan, Vidya Daan, that way, different types of Daan. So physically, externally, it can be Dravya Daan, Dhan Daan, Bhu Daan, Go Daan, Shram Daan, doing something with one's own hard work, labor. Samaya Daan, where I give time to accomplish something, to help a noble cause. So these are Daan at the physical level. Then the subtler Daan is to help somebody, to empower their life through knowledge. So it is said, Annadaan is great. Greater than Annadaan is Vidyadaan. Annadaanam Mahadaanam, Vidyadaanam Mahattaram. The knowledge, if I fund the education of a few people, or I provide some scholarship, I provide some books, uniform, so many things, to facilitate education. That makes that person self-reliant. So greater than Annadaan is Vidyadaan, but greater than Vidyadaan is Abhayadaan, where one gives the knowledge of the self, where the person comes to realize that I am not the Jiva, I am not the ego, I am one with the Supreme Lord. Where the ignorance, the root cause of one's sorrow is destroyed, that is called Brahma Vidya. So the knowledge of that Brahma Vidya, one who shares, knowledge of that Brahman, one who shares, that person is doing Abhayadaan. because that will liberate that person from the cycle of birth and death. So the guru is the one who does the greatest dham. Abhay dham it is called. And whoever that person may be is doing the greatest dham. That's why in the Gita also Bhagavan says in the 18th chapter, adhyeshyate chaya imam guhyam sambadam avayoho bhaktim mai param kritva mame vaishyati asamshayam. Whoever shares this knowledge in whatever way, it need not be only through talk. You know, like Ajay Bhai has made those statues and those various sculptures, and in the office it is there everywhere. So whoever comes there, they see that, they understand, they know about the Gita, they come to know the philosophy. So that is one way of sharing. So like that, in whichever way, one is sharing the knowledge, or that book was brought out. You know, Pandit Jasraj ji sang selected verses, the 18 verses from the Gita. So now those are ways by which one makes this knowledge available to the people. That empowers the lives of people, that creates interest in Brahma Vidya, then they start learning. So that is called Abhay Dham. So this spirit of giving, we must protect. The donor has to be protected, because, you know, why should the donor be protected? Because our mind is very fickle. You know, Yudhishthir, he was winding up his sabha one day and somebody came saying that, Maharaj, my daughter's wedding is there. Can you please help me, give me some dan? I have to take care of the wedding expenses. I am very poor. I seek your help. So Yudhishthir said, you know, I am completing the sabha right now. You come tomorrow. And Bhim started laughing very loudly, and you know, he just was laughing like anything. So Yudhishthir said, what happened? Why are you laughing? He said, I am laughing because you are acting like God. He said, what? He said, because you are sure that you are going to be alive tomorrow. You are sure that that person is going to be alive tomorrow. You are sure that you will have wealth tomorrow. You are sure that you will have the sankalpa of to give also. So many things you are so sure of. So you are Ishvara already. Then Yudhishthir realized that, dan cannot be delayed, postponed, because when the mind turns, we don't know. And it literally happens many times. You know, one starts from one's home and one is feeling so grateful and says, you know, Ganpati Bappa, you have helped me so much. I am so grateful to you. You helped me to overcome this problem. I am coming to have your darshan at Siddhi Vinayak, and I will definitely offer 1,000 rupees today. With that sankalpa, one left the home. Now, as one is going in the car, the mind starts thinking, it makes no difference to Bhagavan anyways. Whatever I offer, everything anyway belongs to him. So I don't need to offer so much. So that amount came down from 1,000 to 500. As one is going in the car, still one comes closer, and then one thinks that, you know, offering is all symbolic. It is bhavana that really matters. Bhagavan understands. In the Gita only he said, give me one drop of water, one fruit, one leaf. You know, so it doesn't matter to him, really speaking. It's a bhavana with which we offer. So I can offer 101 rupees. By the time one actually reaches the temple, one puts 11 rupees. And sometimes one doesn't put also. Because our mind is so fickle, it just changes very fast. Right now, this COVID situation is on. People are going through such difficulties. So many things we can do to support, whether through Annadan support, and so many, you know, in March when it happened, so much of Annadan was done and many organizations came forward. Many of you have supported through various organizations and so many meals were served. So that is a very important aspect, Annadan. Some people, they need clothes, they need some other things. Some people need jobs today. We have to create jobs so that society gets empowered. What Modi ji said, you know, be vocal for local. So start buying things which are made in this country. Encourage the local craftsmen and local, you know, the entrepreneurs and the startups and many of those. So in our own ways, where we can learn to support, where we can learn to give, whatever we have in abundance, one can help. So that spirit of giving has to be protected. In October, that will come, you know, the Joy of Giving Week will come. First week of October, Joy of Giving Week. So protect the donor. So avatvam mam, avavaktaram, avashrotaram, avadataram, avadhataram. Somebody may not be able to give certain things, but they may be able to support a noble cause. Dhata means to nurture, nourish. They may give their time, they may work hard, they may, spend their energy, resources to support a noble cause. Please protect all such supporters who may not have monetary things to give, but they are giving themselves to support a cause. So avavaktaram, avadataram, avadhataram. And support need not be only in terms of physically doing something. Even one can support an organization by spreading the good word about the work that they are doing. Not just condemning, criticizing. You see, today it has become such a sad thing that it is a fashion to do Hindu bashing. And to show Hindu saints in a wrong light, to show Hindu ashrams in a wrong light, and so many web series and movies or many other things that come out in entertainment, they all are doing Hindu bashing and depicting Hindu sadhu sannyasis in such a terrible way. The community needs support to all the good work that is happening. So much of service is being done by the Hindu organizations that people don't realize at all. So that needs a support. I'm just giving one example. Like that, whatever good causes are there, support of those causes needs to get projected. Otherwise, the negative will get projected. Because the negative have come together. The good people have not come together to support each other and strengthen and make people more aware. So the support has to be there for all these good things that are happening. It need not be only in religion, it can be in every other aspect to highlight, to promote the positivity. So avadataram, avadhataram, avanuchanam. Please protect the teacher who is teaching about Vedic knowledge. That is the meaning of anuchanam. The rites, rituals, spiritual knowledge, the empowerment through practices, the celebration of festivals, that is one part. Then protect the teacher who is giving spiritual knowledge also. The knowledge of the absolute self. Protect that teacher. The teacher who helps us to know what is dharma. As a grihastha dharma, what should I do? As a brahmachari dharma, what I should do? Various roles. Who teaches about various roles, what should be done, what should not be done. So such guides or such gurus, such teachers, mentors, who help us to live more ethically. One is who teaches skills. That person is called as Anuchanam, who teaches skills. Other is who empowers through ethical, moral strength and spiritual knowledge. Protect both of them. Avanuchanam, avashishyam. Protect the disciple. Because many obstacles may come, like we said earlier, the disciple may give up the seeking. The enthusiasm for learning may become weak. The desire, the dedication towards the scripture, towards the guru, that becomes less. So protect all these. The physical body may go through sickness. So all those, the first one when we saw, avatvam mam, that same thing we can apply here. Protect in all different ways. Protect the seeker. Avanuchanam avashishyam. Then he says, protect me from all the sides. So generally, when we gain knowledge, we should be facing the east. Or when we meditate, we should be facing the east. Purva or north, uttara. these are two directions which one can face when one is doing any spiritual practice like puja, japa, bhajan, ityadi, or when one is gaining knowledge, when one is listening, one is studying. One must face the north. North is the direction where the great rishis also are sitting there in the Himalayas. They are in the north. And the word uttara literally means to evolve higher. Uttara. Ut means high. So knowledge helps me to lift myself higher. So that is called uttara. So face the north or face the east. South is the direction of death, Yamaraj. So generally the seeker moves away from death towards immortality. So one is seated in the south facing the north, or seated in the west facing the east. Here the seeker is, it is either the seeker is facing the east or facing the west. That's why the mantras here say, protect me from the north, protect me from the south, protect me from the top, protect me from bottom, protect me from all sides. So avapashchatat purastat, front and back, north and south, uttarat and dakshinatat, up and down, urdhvatat dhara avadharatat, and sarvato mam pahi, please protect me from all directions. So cosmic forces, please protect me from rain, thunder, cyclone, all these. It can come to us from anywhere. Protect me from disturbances from the beings around us, and protect me from my own subjective agitations. So in a puja, you will see that a pandit generally will do this, and he will tell you also that lift your hand, make a click, rotate it clockwise, and they will say Om Bhur Bhuvah Suvaha. Meaning, I have locked all the 10 directions, and from 10 directions no disturbance must come, so that I focus in my sadhana. And at the end of the puja, they will unlock it also. So that is a symbol of protection from all sides. That Bhagavan, please protect me from all sides. May this mantra Bhur Bhuvah Suvaha, that is the Vyahriti. So may we be protected from all disturbance in this earth, in the interspace, in the heavens. So this is mantra number 3, seeking protection of Bhagavan. So for today we will stop here. Anything anybody wants to ask, share, you are welcome.
Any questions or comments anybody has?
Namaste ji. Yeah. When you say about asking for protection, is this the way you pray, or you just chant, or I mean, how do you seek it?
Yeah. So when we chant this mantra specifically, yeah, while chanting, it is our prayer. So we bring the meaning into the mind.
Okay.
And pray with bhavana that Bhagavan, please, we need your protection. And
second, Gayatri mantra.
You can chant any mantra actually.
Okay.
You can do Gayatri mantra, Mrityunjay mantra. If you want to chant this mantra specifically asking for protection, that also. Or even your Ishta mantra, whatever, who is your Ishta Devata, chant the mantra of that Devata. One is to chant with bhavana and bringing the meaning in the mind. And second is, at the end of the chanting, visualize that the grace of the Lord pervades me completely and I am protected. If one wants, one can visualize also that the hand of Bhagavan is on my head and the grace of the Lord is on my head and he is protecting me, she is protecting me. So that visualization also is powerful, that also can help.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. So, okay. Next week. ओम असतो मां सद्गमय तमसो मां ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतमय ओम
शांति शांति
हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम
हरि ओम
हरि ओम थैंक यू एवरीवन
हरि ओम
हरि ओम स्वामी जी।